Hello? No, not hello. Hello. Hello? Good?
No? Ah, see, good, better now. Okay. So I'm here to talk about NFTables, which is the not yet ready and that will come soon successor of IPTables. What I've decided to do is to make something that will describe the history of a project a bit so you will be able to understand why we wanted to do that, not just for the pleasure of coding, but because there was something that we want to fix. Because as was mentioned before by Julia Lawal, the coding style evolve, there's new thing coming into the kernel, and they want to improve things. So first of all, who am I? I'm a hacker and contractor. I am working as an open source and security consultant. I've started some time ago, it looks like 10 years ago, the NFW project, which is an authenticating firewall. And I'm now the core developer of one of the core developer of Suricata IDS IPS. And that is for what is making my living. I'm also a member of a NetFilter core team, which is a small team of people which are leading the development on the NetFilter, so on the firewall under Linux. And I'm wo mainly working on in a kernel to user space interaction, and I am the official ULOG2 maintainer. ULOG2 is the daemon for logging inside NetFilter, and I'm responsible of a port of OpenOffice firewall to LibreOffice. Okay, so a little bit of history. The man of the photo is one really great guy. This is Rusty Russell, Paul Rusty Russell, which is an Australian who started, which developed IP Chains in 1997, which was the Linux firewalling in 2.2. It was stateless. And he hit again in 2000 by bringing IPTables on NetFilter to the Linux kernel 2.4. And this new release was bringing some interesting things like the stateful tracking and full NAT support, NAT for network address translation for the people not used to firewall. And in extremis, and we will pivot a long time after, you bring IPv6 support to the Linux firewalling in NetFilter in 2000. Once he has done these two things, he founded the NetFilter project to be able to give momentum to the project so that enough people are always inside the project, working for the project, known as working for the project, so the project has enough momentum to continue to live and not to be completely forgotten. What are the features of a NetFilter? It's a packet filtering framework, so it brings filtering. Nice. Everybody is okay? Okay. So what is bring call as filtering is to filter on protocol field like source port, destination port, source address, things like that. But it also possible to filter on internal state, for example, like the state which come from the connection tracking. We will see a bit after that what it is. And there is also some packet mangling. You're able to change the content of a packet when they cross a NetFilter firewall. You can change the type of service, you can change the time to live, you can also set mark, you can do a lot of things. And this is the first component, and the second component is the connection tracking, which is the new things that came in 2000 after IP chain, the new thing in IPTables and NetFilter, which brings stateful filtering. Stateful filtering is the simple idea of being able to know the history of a packet to see if it is from a flow we know. We already have seen the initialization, for example, of a connection. And on the packet is not completely out of scope, coming out of nowhere. For example, on TCP, we will follow the scenes in ACK thing to see that we will then create a connection inside the system to say, I've seen that a connection has been established from white point to white point, but it has some specific notion associated to it, the source port, the destination port, but also, for example, the TCP window is tracked, so we can not have people coming from outside and try to inject packet inside the TCP flow without having seen everything. That's the main task of connection tracking. The second task is to be able to detect the dynamic connection that can be established, for example, by a protocol like FTP. Like you know, FTP is you connect to port 21, and after that, for every data exchange, there is a dynamic connection which is open between arbitrary ports between the two extremity of the system, of the connection. Sorry. So to detect this, we need to parse the protocol exchange to detect the messages where the server and the client exchange of parameters of the connection, of the dynamic connection that will be open. And once we have done that, we are able to open to detect that a connection on this specific I port, for example, in the case of FTP, on which port this will occur. So by doing this, we are able to track easily the dynamic connection opening. If we were not doing that, what we will have to do is to open everything on the I port, because we don't know where it comes from and on which port it comes from. So by doing this, we are really able to improve the security of the system. And the last thing, the last main component is the network address translation, where you can do a destination network address translation. For example, you've got only one public IP and you redirect the flow coming to port 80 to the internal web server, which has a private IP inside your network. And reverse, the source network address translation, where you have many clients behind one single IP, and you map the source IP of the outgoing packet to the public IP of your gateway. Inside the kernel, NetFilter is mainly some hooks, I mean some point where you can attach code which are put inside the network stack. For each hook, we can verdict can be issued. For example, NetFilter can say it accepts the packet or it drops the packet. But it can also modify the data and modify the SKB. To each point in the kernel correspond at least one table, and we have different families of table. We've got the filter family, which is the classic filtering framework, filtering table, the input forward, the output for the one who knows NetFilter. We've got the NAT table, which is used for network address translation, the Mongol table, which is used to modify the packet, the TTL or TTTOS thing I was mentioning before. And you've also got the row table, which is used to make some operation before the connection tracking. And that can bring some performance because the connection tracking has a cost, and being able to drop a packet before it reaches the connection tracking can bring you some performance improvements. And the second big component inside the kernel is the connection tracking, which is maintaining a hash table, which is from far this is a hash table. And in this hash table, we have a list of known flows in the firewall. And the next task, I've already mentioned the next task of connection tracking, which is to do the detection of dynamic connection for some protocol. So, the NetFilter filtering has very few communication with user space. It just has an AIOCTL which can be used to set up the rule set, or to dump the rule set. On the connection tracking side, it's almost what I mentioned is just a summary of what I mentioned before. It increases security, but it has a cost in terms of performance because you need to analyze every packet to see if they belong to a single flow. And the next component is the IP tables, which is the command line configuration tools, which allow you to update the rule set inside the kernel. In 2005, NetFilter did know its first big evolution by the introduction of NFNetLink, when 2.6.14 was issued. And this NFNetLink system is a message passing system that allows better communication between user space and kernel space. It brings new interaction. For example, we had the NFLog system, which allowed to send packet logging message from the kernel space to the user space and to have something, a program behind to be able to read that messages. We've got NFQ, which was an improved user space decision system, which allow you to ask to user space if a packet has to be accepted or dropped. And the next one, I think this is one of the most interesting one, is the NFCT, which is a complete message system to be able to dump the connection tracking entry, to update the connection tracking entry. Because before, there was almost no communication with the connection tracking system. There was just one entry in slash /pros, which was the list of all the known flows on the system, but it was not possible to use it to get some information, some accurate information, or even on top of that, it was not possible to modify the entries. With NFCT, it's possible to dump the connection tracking, to be in event mode. You can listen to event, and each time a new connection is created, you can get a message which is sent to user space, and this allows you to log interesting things, for example. And this system is based on NetLink, which is a datagram-oriented messaging system, which is mainly used for kernel to user space communication. And it is a formatted system. You've got, it's a binary protocol. Hopefully it's in kernel. You got message, the form of the message is the following. You got message length, you got type of message, and you got some flag you can put. And after that, you can put some data with type. It's a type length value system, which allow you to make some complex messages. The message can be big. And you can put a lot of things inside of the system. But one of the main points of the system is that it's fully binary, so you need to deal with it and to have well-formatted messages. Following 2.6.14, it was possible to discuss with the connection tracking, and one of the first systems to use it was the contract tools, which have been developed by Pablo Nera Ayuso. And the main component of contract tools is ContractD, which was bringing high availability to a NetFilter firewall. In fact, ContractD is doing is that it takes the connection tracking data from one firewall and bring them to another firewall. So in case the first firewall get down, the second firewall know every established flow and is able to work as the previous one, if the previous one is not anymore available. There is also Contract, which is a command line tool which can be used to update and query connection tracking. And at last, there is ulogday2, which is the logging daemon I'm responsible of, which can log packets and also do some connection logging, so it can be used to dump every new connection in a database or in a files. One of the interests of this system is that, for example, it will allow you to dump every network address translation decision, because, for example, if you look at what the outside see from your connection, if you're making some source network address translation, it will only see your public IP, and you will never know which particular IP is at the origin of one specific flow. So by using ulogd2, you can in fact store the mapping and store the network address translation decision. We were in 2005, I think. But it was not completely dead, because in 2011, IP7 does reach the kernel. IP7 was something that was badly needed, which was bringing some efficient set handling. Because one of the main problematic, we'll describe this later, was the fact that a lot of people have some list of servers. For example, you got something like 20 HTTP servers. And if you want to maintain the list of this IP and put that in the rule set, you will need one rules per server, and even one rules per server per protocol, which get you in a high, which create a high number of rules. So by using IPSet, you can have some address list or more complex set that can be used. And it was it occurs in 2.49. And last thing to be added to NetFilter was the NFACCT, which is a NetFilter accounting, which is a simple system which is made to, which is had been created to be able to do some efficient accounting. So on the kernel code side, we have something like 70,000 locations inside the kernel, compared to only 50,000 locations in user space. So we've got a project which is bigger in user space than in kernel space. One of the main explanations of this big size in the kernel size is the fact there is 111 IP tables extension, which is quite a lot, hard to maintain. Which are doing some various tasks. You've got some trivial thing like the TCP extension, which is in charge of being able to match on the TCP destination port, TCP source port, or TCP flag. And you've got some more tricky thing like the cluster thing, which is can be used for load balancing. The statistics, which can be used to drop. The statistics module, which can be used to drop, for example, one packet every 10 packets. That can be funny to be called by the customer service. And you've got BPF, where you can use a Berkeley packet filter to create some advanced filter. So, what are the problems? The first problem is the red one. The red one, this graph is showing the cost in time when adding a new rule to an existing rule set. Below, we have the number of rules in the current rule set. And the other axis is the time needed to add the rules. So we see that with IP tables, we've got an exponential explosion of the time needed to add the rule. It's just awful. The main explanation is that even if you add one single rule with IP tables, the process is the following. You get a binary blob, you ask to the kernel by the IOCTL, a binary blob of the current rule set. You get the rule set, you update the binary blob, and you re-inject back the binary block, the modified binary block to the kernel. So, if you've got a big rule set, then the binary block will get bigger, it will take long to transfer it, and the performance will just suck. And this will be okay, but there is some issue with the network getting more dynamics. There is the cloud thing, there is a lot of server, there is the provisioning thing. So you need to be really fast if you want to adapt your filter on your rule set to the evolving architectures. And as I mentioned before, if you want to be strict and you have a lot of server and a lot of protocol, you will need one rule per server and per protocol. So it's just a complete mess, and your rule set is getting big. So that's why when IPSet was introduced inside the kernel, it was a good thing because it provided an easy way to manipulate set. But it was efficient, but not easy to integrate because you have got IP, you got to manage the set with IP set in a separate way from the rule set. So you got to sync everything like the IP set command on the rule set system. Not really easy. On the developer side, the worst thing was code duplication. As I was mentioned before, IPv6 support was added just at the end of the processes for kernel 2.4. So it was made simply by just duplicating the code for IPv6, changing what needed to change to make some filtering on IPv4 instead of on IPv6, sorry, instead of IPv4. So we had some code duplication. A lot of modules are quite the same code, but one dealing with IPv4, one dealing with IPv6. And to add on this, there has been at start IP NetFilter was just an IP packet filtering system, but then people wanted to add the bridge filtering with EB tables. So we add two systems, one new system with a different working on a different layer, and then we also add the ARP table, which is filtering no ARP. So we've got this code do not share much, and everything has been made twice or third time. There has been work to be able to factorize the thing together, but for now this is very limited. And also, there is one point is that in IP tables, the parsing is manual. I mean, each module has to write its own code for the parsing of the argument. So it brings some complexity. Every module do not behave the same. So it's quite a pain. I already mentioned the binary blob, which is passed from kernel to user space and from user space to kernel where we want to update the rules. The fact that it is binary is a problem because we can have some IBI breakage. And it is not possible to do a modification without touching the kernel. On the security side, the kernel is parsing a binary blob. And this is quite difficult because the blob can be big, can be complex. I recall we have a 111 extension. So this 111 extension have their own parsing system. So it's really easy to potentially break the internal parser by just injecting some data inside the binary blob. Not mentioning the performance issue I was talking before. One other point, which is a problem with IP tables, is the fact that there is no library to use and to insert rules or to modify rules. Almost every frontend have to fork an IP tables command. So it's not really efficient. And it's not really efficient, for example, for network manager who needs to update rules and things like that each time a new network interface came up. There exists libip tables inside IP table source, but it's not a public library. And a lot of people did cry because they had a program and the API was changed, the ABI too, so the program was broken because there is no guarantee of keeping API or ABI when upgrading a version. One other point, I think it's more minor, but it's interesting anyway, it's the fact that the NetFilter infrastructure is, I would say, you have it or you don't have it. I mean, if you load the NetFilter module, then you will have the creation of all the different hooks, the activation of all the different hooks inside the kernel. And this will induce some performance cost because you will have to go at least to check, even that if there is no rules, you will have to call the function to go to the system to check that there is a rule or not. And that induces a bit of performances and cost. And the problem is that there is no configuration possible. This is fully hard-coded. And for example, the forward chain, which is used for gateway, is installed on a server. So for the different reasons, NFTable was proposed by Patrick McCarty. The idea is to not to change everything, but just to change the filtering part and the command line interface. There is no change in the hook. The hook are maintained. The connection tracking is not changed. The helpers, which help the connection tracking for dynamic opening, are maintained too. The change is just in the filtering. One of the big critics that IPTables was confronted with is the fact that the command line is somewhat strange. I like it, but I use it for so long time, so maybe that's the point. And now the on the IPTable syntax was just oriented with command line, and there's no real language behind. So that's one of the point. That's why it's complicated. So the NFTables, the choice was to use a grammar and to make this grammar accessible from a library. So the frontend will be able to use it. To have a feature accessible from a library, so the frontend will be able to use it. And as you may have guessed, to use a netlink-based communication, 2.6.14 was the change for NetFilter beginning to use a netlink. And now, finally, the main component, something like 10 years after, will finally change to netlink. NFTables were introduced in 2008 by Patrick McCarty at the NetFilter workshop 2008. I've been very kind with Fulitaro because I've got good pictures of him on the boat. it was a party just after the 3 hours of presentation on NFTables that had been made by Patrick. It was wow. In fact, everybody was completely astonished by the work that that Patrick had been done all by himself. It's just awesome code, awesome conception, awesome architecture. But the thing is that he was alone to do it, and I think it was so big that nobody did join the effort. And the development started in 2008, first release in alpha release in 2009, and that was all for a small time. So, no, not yet. Let's make a break. If it works. Ooh, come on. Yeah. Okay, so as you see, we've got one guy, Patrick McCarty, which is working on NFTables user space here. And here it's lib NL NFT, which was a maintained fork of lib NL library. So Patrick is working all alone on his code, touching a bit libNFT. But libNL NFT, this is, as you see, it's contribution in overbranch as the one that Patrick is using. For the record, the video is made with Gurs, which is a nice software. We just start Gurs from your Git repository, your Asvin repository, and we will do that without any params. So now we are in 2009. There is almost no work. Yes, the project is dead in August 2009. We just have some change in the libNL NFT. Still 2009. A little bit of work. And then. No, not then. Soon. So it was still a bit working in 2009. And then, yes, well, 2010, January. But it still just work on the libNL NFT. And by the way, it's Thomas Graf, main author of libNL NFT. So we had a release in 2010, I think. So a few contributes came at that moment. But it did not maintain in the time. And so we have jumped to August 2012, where Pablo Neira has been founded by Astaro Sophos to take back the development. And he created libNFTables, which is the library which is now used to work with NFTables, and which is accessible by the user. And you can see that the work effort is almost constant during that time. Patrick McCarty joining back the project for a bit. And one interesting thing is that I think, which color is this? Well, yes, the Thomas Bursiska on top right, on the bottom right, sorry, is a guy which is working on Conman, which is a network manager. And this was, I think it was one of the guys who cried when the libreptables API did change. So he said, okay, with NFTables, I will have a library, so I will use it. So he start hacking on the system. And now we're in just recent time, Google Summer of Code, we had 3 students for the NFTables project. So he start to work a bit faster than before. As you can see, the activity is really increased previously, compared to previously. And there is new component coming, like the IPTables and NFTables, which is a compatibility layer with IPTables. I will get into detail after that on this. Yes, IPTables and NFTables is added to the tree. Okay, so we're almost done. We're in end of August 2013. And it's just more people working on the system. So getting back to the slide. What explanation on the failure of original failure of NFTables in 2008? I think maybe it's release of Patrick should have done a release often, a release early, like was saying Linus, because it was too big. It's 2 or 3 components, it's high-level coding. So if you get to enter in the project without starting it from the beginning, it's very hard. You can do it. It has been done by Pablo and other guys, but it's really, really complex. One other thing maybe is the fact that it's too early. IPSet was available at the time. It was already fixing most of the issue that people had. So yes, the IPSet was a sufficient solution for dynamic handling, for dynamic rule set. So why do we need more? Okay, this one I've already stated. So how does the beast look like? The first thing is that one of the main points we had with IPTables is the fact that for each match, the TCP per match, the UDP per match, for each match, we need to put code inside the kernel. So, but if you look at what is a TCP per match or what is a UDP per match, it's almost the same. It's just you jump in the payload at a given place. You look to 16 bit of data to get the integer, and you make a comparison on the integer. So it's quite simple. So the idea Patrick had was to say, I can make something inspired by Berkeley packet filter, where we create a pseudo state machine which will be able to do the matching in a generic way. For example, you can do with a packet payload, you can do a match on almost every data which are placed at a fixed offset inside the packet. For example, the packet payload can make the match on an IP address and can make the match on TCP port or TCP or UDP port. So by using a set of different instructions, it's possible to build almost any filter or maybe more filter from what we had before. For example, this simple match below was completely impossible before. What it's doing is just checking that the source port is equal to the destination port. not really useful, but it shows the power of the system. You just have to call, you put in the register one, you put the payload at the offset source port. Register two, do the same thing, but the destination port, and you do a comparison, and you can use this comparison to do verdict, matching, or thing like that. I see some big open eyes. Oh no, I don't want to write this, it's too complicated. So the main difficulty after that will be to convert that from human readable language to this Berkeley packet filter syntax. In the kernel, NFTable brings some changes. As was mentioning, the tables were all created at once with IP tables and filter. With NFTables, this is the user who creates the tables by just sending messages on the netlink socket. It's got the standard operation add, delete, dump, thing like that. In the user space, there is libmnl, which is a generic low-level netlink interaction library, which is not supposed to be known by people using NFTables. And there is libnftables, which is handling the low-level interaction with the NFTables netlinks API. And finally, there is NFTables, which is the command line utility, which is used to maintain the rule set. So the chain are created on demand. You just send a specific message, and in that message, you specify where it does attach. For example, you can call dehors ou sortie, create a chain called sortie, which is bound to the output hook. And if you say it's a root chain, it's a root type, in fact, it will be a Mangle table where you can put change TTL, toss, something like that. If you say it's a filter type, then it will be the classical output chain we add in netfilter. As I mentioned before, the syntax of a Berkeley packet filter is not really easy to write. There is a lot of complicated things. It's almost assembly language. So one of the main tasks of the NFTables project is to convert the input from the user, which is made in a human readable language, and to convert it to a binary netlink message. As I showed you before, the binary netlink messages are just tip length value protocol. So you've got to convert something that is like a text to this binary system. So it's made by a classic system. There is tokenization, where you convert a word into a token. Then you've got the parsing. Then you've got the evaluation. The evaluation, for example, is to convert an IP hostname into an IP address. And next step is the big step, is the linearization, where you take all the data you've got from your rules, you make a grammar tree and ST3, and you convert this to a netlink message. And you've got the reverse, which in my way is, I think, maybe more interesting, because you've got to take the netlink messages. For example, you ask the kernel for a specific dump, and you need to convert the netlink message to a readable text. So you've got to delinearize, sorry, even in French it's hard to say, the netlink message. You've got to do some processing, and you've got to textify the message. To give an example, we've got here one single rules, which is, in fact, I want this destination address to be put a rules on this destination address. So you see, you got the payload church, header plus 16, put this in register one, do a bitwise operation, which means we will just make a mask operation on the register. And then you make a comparison with the IP address which is here just an integer. And if it's okay, then you got the counter. So you see, the transformation is not obvious. You get this the top line as an entry, and you convert it to this filter below. It's not really easy. So big work has been made on this. On kernel side, there is one interesting thing, is the fact that there is it's possible to do some automatic rule set update. You can say, you can add, for example, 10 different rules, and you say, now they are active. You make a commit operation, which activate all the rules, and which is made made with an interesting system, which is using only 2 bytes to say if the rule is active in the present, deactive in the past, something like that. Next point is interesting, is the Xtables compatibility. The idea is to, as you may guess, you don't have really seen the user interface for now, but you will guess it will change a lot. So there are a lot of people have already big iptables rule set, and we don't want to force people to upgrade just at once. We forgot netfilter iptables, and now everybody switched to netfilters. I don't think it will work. So a compatibility will be provided, and as I mentioned before, there is a lot of extension. We don't want to port every extension to the native language. So to do so, there is an Xtable compatibility layer which has been developed, and so it's now possible to use the old extension inside Xtables. One point that can be of interest for security people mostly is the event notification. It's possible to send a message to user space each time rules is modified, added or deleted, and this is implemented in libnftables, and by using libnftable, program can subscribe to the event and be able to get information as soon as a rules is modified. So, what are the advantages of this approach? First thing is limitation in kernel size. We switch from something I think was 70,000 to 7,000 line inside the kernel. So it's really a big change. And we've got a big change too, is that the kernel size in terms of code was bigger from the user space side for netfilter, and we completely change this with netfilters because we got 50,000 location in user space against 7,000 in kernel space, so it's seven times more code inside the user space than inside the kernel space. So it's a big change. And this is mainly explained by the Berkeley packet filter things, where a lot of match can be easily translated, in fact, by the user space into the language, and it's just some small snippet of code, meaning in Berkeley packet filter language, that are sent from the user space to the kernel space, and the kernel space only know the Berkeley packet filter. It don't have to know about TCP deport. It don't care about it. The instructions that have been put in the pseudo state machine are instructions which allow to write almost everything that has been written since the 10 years of from the start of the project. So they should be sufficient, and if they are not sufficient to write a new target, a new instruction will just be one single function inside the Berkeley packet filtering system, so it's quite a small change. When I've seen my first presentation about NFTables during the workshop, I was thinking, well, yes, cool, I will be able to do some things in user space. But some times ago, maybe 2 months ago, I was trying to filter ICMPv6 with NF tables, and it was not working. So I say, okay, let's patch it. And I start to look at the code, and I just realized that, oh, I just need one user space patch to make ECMPv6 filtering. And it's not a big one. I've got just to add some code in pilot.c, which is inside nftable. I didn't even touch the libnftable library. I just touched the command line utilities to add ECMPv6 filtering. And it's just 59 added line to the main file. The rest is just small crap, like adding support for ECMPv6 in the scanner, something very small. And if we look at the code, it's just sexy. We just have, I declare a structure which is ECMPv6. I declare some operation. And I just declare that the type is here. And in fact, it will use the structure, the description of the structure, to be able to magically fetch the information inside the structure defined in another header. So you just have to say, that this code, which is defined in the header file, which is standard header, has to be used to get access to the field. So it's really simple. I think this is the 59 lines of code are here. So it's really elegant. So now, this is what's for the developer now. On the user side, there is a file mode. It's possible now to play one single file with NFT. It's simple. We got the command line. For example, the first line is adding a rule in filter input, so a filtering rule in input for the TCP destination port 80. I just say that I want to drop this. Next one is listing the rules inside the filter table. And the third one is a simple rule which you say, I want to delete the rule with handle 10. The handle is, it's not displayed. The handle can be displayed here. For example, you given the handle, so you can dump the rules and then access to the handle number, and then you can delete the rules. There is a clear command line interface mode with a dash E option, when you can make almost every option. And you got ever some error reporting. With your tables, you've got error 4444567, and you got to guess what it was. Here you've got error, and sometimes it's really useful because it just points you to the place where you make the mistake in the rule. In terms of functionality, one really interesting thing is the set handling. It is possible to define set inside the rule set. You don't have to use a separate tool like IPSet to do so. For example, you can define an anonymous set to say, I want to filter, I want to accept the packet to port 22 and 443 for these two set of IP address, one IP address and one network. So you see you've got something which is very concise, very small, very focused on what you want to do. If you want to do that with a net filter, you will just have two separate rules, because one for each IP address. The problem with that one is that if you have this, you can't add a new one after. You just have to delete or add the rules. So it's possible to use name set, where you define a set which is called IPv4 address. Choose a name here, and you add element to the IPv4 address. You delete element to the IPv4 system, and you can use it inside an NFT rules. For example, I want to drop this packet. The interest of this set is that it's stored inside a hash in the kernel, so it's fast to match, and even faster from the previous thing we had with IP tables, which was one line, one new rules, which has to be checked one by one if we did not use IPSet. A bit more complex is the mapping. The idea is to associate two notions, for example, one address and one verdict. And you can say, I want to that address is accepted, and that one inside this network is dropped. So this is the first example here. You say, I want to add a filter on the IP destination address with the map, which is, if it's inside the network where it is dropped, then if it is with IP address, this is an accept. If you want to play with NF tables, please note that you have some already used by bash character inside the notation, which is quite a nasty thing because you've got to quit almost everything. So I heavily recommend to use the CLI interface because it will spare you sometimes not understanding why your rules is bad. And you can also do some named mappings, the same thing as the set, where you can say, I want to map IPv4 address to verdict. And you add element and you add a rule, you can just add this one here. When inserting thing two is that you can combine a verdict. The people that are using IP tables know that you cannot do dash j log on dash j accept. And with NF table, you can say counter log accept, it will create a counter, it will log the packet, and it will accept the packet. So it's a big change because this was causing some overload in the rule set because you had to specify twice the two things at the same time. And you add one rules for the logging, one rule for the drop, which was painful to maintain. Let's see one usage example. We define a set of web servers that we have in our network, two first line, a set web server with two IP address inside. And we got a map we defined for the admin. And we want that the admin, which is on the 44 address, is jumped to logmetender, which is a chain, user space chain we will define after. And if the for the 42, we wanted to jump to logmetrue, so logmetender and logmetrue for the admin, and just accept for the over one. And so the typical rule set will look like that. In chain forward, the CTI, it's the connection tracking call. So if a packet is an established, if a packet belongs to an established connection, then I accept. CTI state established, accept. And then you can just use the mapping. If somebody is trying to connect in SSH to the web server, I use the admin map, which is accept in all case, but not for the two IP address, where I will have counter log accept and just accept in another case. So by doing this, you almost have said anything for the administration of your system. You've got differentiated logging, following the IP address, you've got different decisions. For example, we could have said, here it's a drop for everyone, but an accept for the two specific one. So you see that in one line, you've got something that you was making for, I think, in maybe six or eight different rules. And then you can just have an accept for the HTTP and HTTPS on your web server. I could have used a set by the way, but I just want to log the HTTP connection here, so I make a difference. As I mentioned before, there is IP tables, which has now what is called IP tables and NF tables, which is something that is compatible with IP tables and that will be usable, that will be used to be able to push some IP table rule set to NF tables kernel. This will allow a progressive update on the client side. And this is yet to do. It's a high-level library which will be used by frontend to be able to add rules without knowing almost nothing on the system, which will also be used by network manager system. And conclusion, this is a huge evolution. It solves most of the problem, It's an answer to new usage with the set handling with complex matches. Regarding availability, I hope it will be end of 2013, but I think mostly the case will be the start of 2014. And because there is a lot of things remaining to finalize the IP tables compatibility, the high level library is not done, but we could wait a bit for this. It's just a library. And there is a lot of debug on some functionality. By the way, if you want to play on a nice open source project with great code, it's the place. So if you have questions, a big thanks to the NetFilter team for this beautiful work, and for I would like to mention it, but for Asteros and Sophos for the financing the development, because they do not use it before maybe 2 or 3 or 4 years. It's just financing free software. Google for Google Summer of Code. If you want to start playing with it, you got a small quick and dirty how-to I've wrote, which may give you a step by step on how to compile your kernel, things like that. And if you got questions, I'm here. Thank you.
Some question? Yeah.
What about connection tracking? Does NFTables impact it? Are helpers for connection tracking moved from kernel space to user space?
No, not at all. There's no change at all in the connection tracking. There's not one line change in the connection tracking. The connection tracking can be accessed by is unchanged and is accessed by this specific match city, where you can say the match is here is August established. There's no change on this one. The helper on connection tracking are unchanged. Only the filtering framework is updated.
Is it possible to atomically access multiple tables at once? Because I have an example with IP tables. When you want to add a NAT rule, for example, you have to add a forward rule in the NAT table and a forward rule.
I did not check the atomic thing, but from the part of code I've read, I think it's the case, almost sure. Because each rule has the bit that can be flipped at the same time, so it should be okay.
And you can access multiple tabs with the same...
There's no link.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
You killed them all.
Yeah. It's the food.
Since there is an abstract representation of the rules, you could optimize the rule set. I mean, if you have a set of rules starting with the same condition, you could if you factor out this condition. Is it something planned?
I don't heard about this was planned. I think it is a straight thinking that it could be used. It could be done. One problem I see is that the converting back the result will be difficult, so you may not be able to judge what the result is. But at least it could bring some performance or some fixes, some fixed rule set. It could be interesting. Yeah.
Other question? Thanks, Eric.
Thank you.